Hello, everyone. Welcome to the next seminar. It's my greatest pleasure to introduce Aditya Potukuchi. We'll talk about some inapproximability of hypergraph coloring problems.
Okay. Thanks a lot for having me. Is this audible? Is this audible, right? So everything I'll present is joint work with based on joint work with Per Oster and Amay Bangale. Per is currently in KTH Stockholm and Amay is in UC Riverside. I plan to present proofs in more or less the almost all details. So please feel free to stop me at any point and just interrupt me at any point if anything is not clear. Okay, so I guess some basic notations. So for a set, for a collection of K sets of 1 to N is called a K uniform hypergraph or a K graph for short. The set N are called the vertices and the elements of H are called the hyper edges. So I'll forget to say hyper once in a while. And the hyper edges are denoted by E, F, etc. In fact, I'll only use E to denote a hyper edge. So that's some basic notation. For the most part in this talk, K is something, for the most part, K is a large but fixed constant and N is growing. So K is a, So that's the definition of hypergraph, the terminology, and the colorings of hypergraphs. So a C coloring is just, I'll use chi to denote a coloring, and the elements of the set are called colors. Chi is proper if every edge has at least two colors. So in words, no edge is monochromatic. Chi is rainbow if the edges in every, sorry, the set of colors in every edge is the set of total colors that you have to work with. So that means every edge sees every color. Okay, so that's the, so this is the, these are definitions. Last bit of definition, I guess. H is C colorable if there is a proper C coloring, and H is C rainbow colorable if there's a rainbow C coloring. So again, so these are just definitions. So here are how problems look like. So here's a problem template. The input is a C colorable K graph H, right? So you have the promise that it is C colorable and you want to output a proper decoloring of this hypergraph. So for such a coloring to always exist, you at least need to ensure that D is at least C. So then you can ensure that such a coloring is always there. In fact, so the case when C is equal to D is essentially the question, is HC colorable? So if you can do this question and you can do, you can do this in pretty much the same time. Okay. So this is a famously NP-hard problem. So it's NP-hard if K is 2, that means it's a graph and you're talking about at least three colors, or it's NP-hard if it's a hypergraph of higher uniformity and you're talking about at least two colors. Okay. So we're interested in D is more than C. And for now, for example, let's say K equal to 2. Even here, recently, the best known results, which are fairly recent, as you can see, is that it's NP-hard to color a graph, a C colorable graph with D colors if D is at most 2C minus 1. Another bound is it's NP-hard to color if D is at most C choose C over 2 minus 1. So this looks like it's a better bound, but really this is worse for small c. So the best thing that we know for graphs is that it's NP-hard to 5 color a 3 colorable graph. So this is kind of state of the art for graphs. And upper bounds, you can color it using some n to the, say, 0.19 colors. Okay, so right, so we'll care about higher values of K also. Okay, it's NP-hard if, so I'm going to show you a bunch of results. Pick them out, which I thought they were somewhat relevant, and they're kind of local maxima of this type of results. So I'll just present them. So we know that for k equal to 4, 4 uniform, 2 colorable hypergraphs, you can't color it with log n to the omega of 1 colors. It's NP hard to color it. This is by Pangale. For k equal to 8 and c equal to 2, or k equal to 4 and c equal to 4, you can't color it with fewer than 2 to the poly log n colors. And for k equal to 3 and c equal to 3, d needs to be, for k equal to 3, c equal to 3, you can't color it with some, essentially log n many colors. I put a star because it's not really NP-hard, it's like quasi NP-hard, but it's for this talk, I won't really distinguish between them. And I guess one range that's of interest is the k equal to 3 and c equal to 2, and then d equal to, I need some epsilon over here. Okay. So essentially, so this result by Dinur, Regev, and Smythe, this is what we will be interested in. In fact, it's not the result itself, but it's kind of the technique that they use, which will be the basis of a lot of the proofs that I will talk about today. Okay, so that's coloring. So here's another problem template. So now the input is a C rainbow colorable K graph. So everything is same except for this. You have a stronger guarantee on the coloring, and you want to output a proper decoloring of H. So this was studied in the this was studied as a weaker notion, a much stronger notion of colorability first in this paper by Austin, Gurusamy, and Hostad. And just as a sanity check, we can check that here's an observation. If it is C rainbow colorable, right? C is more than 2, then it is 2 rainbow colorable. And that's easy because, for example, say, suppose this was an edge and this is how you rainbow color it. So you can identify the first 4 colors with just the color red and the last 3 colors with just the color blue, and that's a 2 rainbow colorable graph. 2 rainbow colorable is exactly the same as 2 colorable. That means no, it is monochromatic. And if it's 2 colorable, then it's also decolorable for D more than 2. So this is definitely something that exists. The point is to find it. Okay. Right. So that is the problem template that I'll talk about. And this problem I'll call RC for rainbow colorable, K as in uniformity, C as in rainbow colorability, and D as in the output number of colors. So these are this is how this problem is parameterized. Here's one range of parameters where C equal to K, like it's K uniform, K rainbow colorable hypergraph, and you're looking to color it with 2 colors. Right? And this was known to be, and you can do this efficiently. This is by McDermott, like this was a randomized algorithm, which was later made deterministic. Okay. So this is like the extreme. You cannot possibly have k plus 1 rainbow colorable k uniform graph. So in this extreme case, it's efficiently doable. And in fact, pictorially, this is how it looks. So what is a what is a k uniform k rainbow colorable graph? So you have a bunch of color classes, right? So these are the color classes, and every edge contains exactly one vertex from each color class. So they're just the transversals over here. Okay, and what the previous result said was that if it is K rainbow colorable, that is if it's K partite, then you can efficiently two color it. Okay, I guess of course the caveat is that you don't know the colors, you don't know this partition yet, so that's kind of the difficulty here. Okay, but in this particular case, you can efficiently two color it. So this is what we know, and it's a conjecture by Brekensik and Guruswamy, which says that this is pretty much the limit, which says that if you take a K uniform, K minus 1 rainbow colorable graph, two coloring it is NP hard for K at least 3. So I say K at least 3, I really mean K at least 4, because 3 is easy. It's easy in the sense it's known. Okay, and towards this, I guess some kind of partial progress is if you have a K uniform graph, which is K over 2 rainbow colorable, coloring it with any constant number of colors is NP hard. Okay, but this is a much weaker condition than this. And so, right, like I said, k equal to 3 is easy in the sense that this is just the two colorability of three uniform hypergraphs, the result I mentioned in the very first part of the thing. So really, 4 was the smallest unknown case. And that was where, like, so that was the first theorem, this joint work with the pair and Amey. So the previously smallest case is now taken care of. And to try and extend it, it works for k uniform, k minus order square root k rainbow colorable graphs. Two coloring is NP hard. So this is supposed to be k minus 1 if the conjecture is true. So it's k minus order square root k. Right. Okay. And the proof kind of follows the Dinur-Regev-Smith framework, and I'll explain the details, and I'll explain the proof in more or less full detail. So just stop me. So here are some basic preliminaries. So the reduction is from a label cover instance. So label cover means like, yeah, you have a bunch of variables, which so these are the variables, and these are the constraints between variables, and so like they have, there's a bipartite graph structure for now, and right, so the constraint is called phi. So this is a special type of constraint, but the set of constraints is called a capital phi, right? And this is the, so these are the, so this is how the label cover instance is defined. Every x in xi, which is xi means x1 or x2, every x in xi takes values from some range, right? This kind of is specified with the problem. And in this case, these are also projection constraints in the sense that for every assignment to x, there is at most one assignment to y that satisfies this constraint. Right? And so these are called projection constraints. And I guess if I say x gets A, then I'll just define its projection to be B. Okay. So like that's just to keep it so that next time I don't have to define it every time. So in fact, the instance is slightly more complicated in the sense you have a bunch of, you don't just have two layers, you have L layers of vertices, and you have some extra conditions on the structure of this graph also. So the relevant theorem is the following. So this is a label cover instance. So this is the theorem. So this is again Dinur-Regev-Smith and Dinur-Guruswamy both again, which is for L greater than 2 and R, which is, I mean, for fix a number of layers, and R is kind of the range of every alphabet, the range of the values that every variable can take. And given a label cover instance, it's NP hard to distinguish between there existing a satisfying assignment or there every assignment satisfies at most a tiny fraction of constraints between every two layers. Okay, so this is the theorem. This is the hard problem that we deduce from. So in fact, so there's a bit more detail than there's a bit more detail than is really relevant for this proof. So I'll just give a kind of a stripped down version, and then you can believe that is the hard problem. So for now we're just sticking with two labels. It's just two layers of variables. And given a label cover instance with range is in R1 and R2, which are both reasonably large, it's NP hard to distinguish between there existing a satisfying assignment and every assignment satisfies at most some, say, 1 over R, poly R fraction of constraints. Okay. And moreover, this graph looks, think of this graph as some pseudo-random or complete graph. So you take subsets of vertices and subsets of variables, and they have as many constraints between them as you'd expect. So roughly speaking. But for the details that I'm giving, this is really this is good enough. Okay, so I guess the main thing I would like to showcase are the gadgets. So here's a gadget for the rainbow, for the special 432 case. It's the following. The vertex set is just 012 to the M. It's all 012 to the M. And this is the hypergraph. This is the gadget R3M, which is, you know, it's a three uniform hypergraph on the vertex set 012 to the M, such that the hyper edges are defined, if like UVW form a hyper edge, if the following happens. For every I in M, you see at least two of these three alphabets in every coordinate. And for at most one coordinate, you see exactly two alphabets. So just to make it concrete, here's an example. So here's UVW. You see all three alphabets again, like all three. In this exact one coordinate, you see only two alphabets, and everywhere else you see all three. Okay. So this, in this case, this is kind of called the noisy coordinate. So you have at most one noisy coordinate. That is a hyperedge relation here. So this is easy, is that the independence number is at most two thirds fraction of the vertices, right? Because if you take more than two thirds, you see a coordinate with all three repeating. Sorry, yeah. So this is easy. What was not easy for us, again, it's, once you know how to do it, it's pretty simple. It's that this is not too colorable. And something that we don't know how to do, but I think is really interesting, it has nothing to do with in approximation, is that the independence number is actually less than half of the vertices. So in fact, it's the Hamming ball that goes just, the maximal independence, it is a Hamming ball. So whatever, however big you can make that is the independence, right? And this has nothing to do with, the lower bound is easy, and the conjecture implies whatever this theorem is. So that's not how we prove this theorem finally. So I guess that's a hint. But yeah, so this is a nice problem that I like regardless. So here's a reduction. So I guess I'll mention at least one more reduction, and they kind of follow similar templates. Again, so yeah, so these are close to DRS. So right, here are your two layers. So what you do is the following. Pick a constraint x, y, right? Like, so pick two variables that are joined by a constraint. So firstly, replace every variable with a copy of this the gadget. Okay, this is how I represent it. Like, so when I talk about x, the orange hue is the copy of the hypergraph associated with that vertex. So consider three vertices in this hypergraph, and one UVW and one vertex Z, right? So you put a hyper edge if the following happens. Firstly, these three form a hyper edge themselves, okay? And secondly, in every coordinate, UK, VK, WK, and Z projection of K, you see all three alphabets. Okay. So recall, in the hypergraph, in all but one coordinate, you see all three alphabets. But whatever coordinate that noisy thing is, it's made up for by its projection on the Z vertex. So that's how you place the hyperedge. Okay. And yeah, the completeness is pretty easy. It's the following. Suppose you have an assignment that satisfies all of them. I have to show rainbow three coloring, right? So suppose you have an assignment that assigns A to X. Look at the coordinate A. You just assign whatever is here as a color of U. I mean, you color it 0, 1, or 2, and you just assign whatever is here to the color of that vertex. So firstly, let's just verify that this works. Consider a hyperedge. Firstly, this must form a hyperedge in A3 itself. So in all the non-noisy coordinates, if A is non-noisy, like that means you see all three colors right here. But if A is noisy, you only see two colors. But then because it's a projection constraint, the remaining color is made up for by this vertex here. So you see all four. That's strange. Okay, I'm sorry. That seems to be a technical difficulty. Anyway, right. So by construction, UA, VA, WA, and Z, the projection of A gives you all the three colors. This is what you need for the, which is what you need for the rainbowness. Okay, good. So that's a completeness. And here's a soundness. So this is what we have to show. If H is two colorable, then there is an assignment satisfying at least some, say, 1 over 64 fraction. So in the proof sketch, it will be more like half, but some, yeah, it's a constant fraction of constraints, more than what the, it's within the range of the label cover theorem that we use. Okay, so suppose, this is how you consider the two colors are red and blue, which is this color and this color. So these are the two colors. Now we know that this hypergraph is not two colorable, so it must have a monochromatic edge. And so this is a monochromatic edge U1, V1, W1. And consider three such, for every vertex you have a U1, V1, W1, U2, you have a monochromatic edge, and even for Y. So I guess one thing is that I've drawn all of them in the red color. And again, so that is a detail that's really by standard averaging and pigeonhole arguments, you can get that. Like you can assume that all of the monochromatic edges are red. And moreover, all of these vertices have more than one third red. Sorry, all of these clouds have more than one third red vertices. So the point is it's not just two colorable, you have a monochromatic edge. Because the independence number is two third, any color class more than two third has a monochromatic edge. So you have, you might as well assume that you have a good track. And this is really what will be something you can't assume when you go beyond two colors as a kind of a spoiler. But let's assume that this is how your situation looks. You have X1, X2, X3, all of them are connected to Y, and they all have red monochromatic edges, and all these clouds have a good fraction of red vertices. Okay? Right. And And consider a Z such that it forms an edge with all of these monochromatic edges. Right? It forms a hyperedge in the construction with all these monochromatic edges. So let A1, A2, A3 be the noisy coordinates in these hypergraphs. So just again, suppose they don't have it, it's the easier part. So suppose they have a noisy coordinate. Let A1, A2, A3 be the noisy coordinates in these hyperedges. The point really is that when you take their projections, suppose they project onto distinct points. Right? So suppose this is A1, and suppose A1 projects here, A2 projects here, A3 projects here, like they have distinct projections. The point is every projection places a lot of restrictions on Z. For example, any red, so for example, yeah, let's suppose that these are the actual coordinates here, like A1 has 0, 0, 1. That means if a red vertex, any red vertex cannot have 2 here, because then that would form a hyperedge. So all the red vertices must have either 0 or 1 in this point. And similarly, if for any z prime which is red, the projection of the first coordinate cannot be 2 because 2 is missing here. The projection of the second coordinate cannot be 0. The projection of the third coordinate cannot be 2. So this means a fraction of red edges is at most, say, 2/3 cube, because you place already 3 restrictions on it. But when you assume it's at least 1/3, that's a contradiction. You can't have that. So you only project onto at most 2 values, but 2 is not very important. You project onto some bounded number of values. And the point is, if you pick, right, and here's how you find an assignment to the vertex, right? For every xi, just assign it to its noisy coordinate that was part of the analysis. And for y, just pick randomly among these. You satisfy at least half the constraints in expectation. Right? So that's what this is. So you give xi what you analyze as a noisy coordinate, and y is just one of the two things at random. So the probability that a constraint is satisfied is half. On expectation, you satisfy at least half. And that is the end of the proof. So I guess it's a good. Okay, so any questions so far? So the only detail that did not give are how you get 1/3 red edges and how you just manage to remove the extra layer. But those are just standard averaging arguments. I was trying to kind of advertise the gadgets anyway. So this was the gadget for 4-3-2, right? So the gadget for higher uniformity looks as follows. So I think I confused D and K. But anyway, so for higher uniformity, this is the gadget that works. The vertex set is again some 1 to d to the n. So the vectors which are over alphabet of size d. And you have a d uniform hypergraph. And the hyperedge relation is given by as follows. If this, so d minus, so d minus all the coordinates you see at state j, the sum of all of them must be less than r. So in other words, like pictorially, how does this look? So when you write down x1 to xd, you want to see all d alphabets in every coordinate, right? So the total number of missing alphabets summed over all the coordinates is at most r. So suppose here you only see d minus 1, here you only see d minus 1, and so on for r. That's it. Everywhere else you see D, that's hyperedge. Okay. The point is that this is also not too colorable, and it's used in a somewhat similar way to get the hardness that I was talking about.
Can I have a question about a gadget?
Yeah.
So for r equals 1 and the right parameters for the rest is the same gadget as before, right?
Yes, for r is r1 and d3, it's the same thing as before, because you only get to see one missing coordinate in total.
Yeah, excellent. Thanks.
Okay, so the hope was to show the hardness of 2 colorable, right? So the hope was to want maybe try and increase this 2 to 3, like that was the hope at this point. And yeah, unfortunately we have only partial progress towards that. and I'll describe the partial progress. So you don't really have rainbow colorable as a promise. You have almost rainbow colorable. So this is what CS colorable means, which means you can color the vertices using C colors so that every edge sees at least S colors. So this is somewhat of a generalization of rainbow coloring. So most every edge gets most colors. So that's how you should think of it. And S and C are pretty close. And by the way, so the problem template is as follows. Given a CS colorable hypergraph, find a proper decoloring. So here you have to, again, think of C as close to D so that the existence of this, sorry, C close to S, so that the existence of this guarantees this. Because as stated, that's not obvious either. So let's name this RC as in rainbow coloring, K uniformity, CS colorable, and output with T colors. So that's kind of thing. By the way, if S is equal to C, this is just C rainbow colorable. So a theorem we proved here was, again, RC, K, K minus square root CK, K minus 3 square root CK, C is NP-hard. So you can increase this at the rate of dropping C more than dropping S. So that was the second result. And so again, this is also, I'll describe the gadget, and I think the reason it's not RKCC is that probably the gadget should have been better. But anyway, I'll describe the gadget. A slightly simplistic one. So the vertex set is again n length strings over alphabet of size d, and it's a d uniform hypergraph. And the edge relation is if the number of coordinates where you don't see all d is at most t. So the number of coordinates, So I'm not counting what alphabets you see and what you don't see, but just the number of coordinates where you don't see every alphabet is at most t, because this technique cannot distinguish between these things. And more specifically, the bound on the chromatic number cannot use this extra information. So this is a theorem, which is that this hypergraph is not, so as you increase this noise, the chromatic number increases linearly. It's not T colorable for D greater than 2 prime, for any odd prime particular. So this uses similar ideas as Lovaas's proof of the Kinesser graph chromatic number. It's pretty interesting. I don't know. So, okay, forget the dependence on D. The dependence on T, T square. So unlike in the previous case, I don't really have a strong conjecture here, but this seems to, so there's a gap. It's not this, it is this, and so. In fact, even D equals 2 is interesting here. So, okay, anyway. So I think this was actually a known conjecture. I couldn't find any source for this, but I think this is a known problem, and same kind of thing manifests itself here. Okay, so that's all I have to say about rainbow coloring. So here are some open problems. So the first is this main conjecture that has been unsolved as of yet. But one thing is that now the smallest open case is k equal to 7, because in a somewhat recent work by Guruswamy and Sandeep, like they take care of 5 and 6. So whatever it was presented, so whatever we did with Ame pair and Ame, it doesn't work for 5. But yeah, it can be made to 5. And in fact, they do something much more general. So you don't want to just color the graph, you want to output a rainbow coloring of the graph. So that's the second thing, which I think should be more easy, is this one. Just instead of CS, just remove the almost rainbow colorability. Okay, good. So that's what I wanted to say about the rainbow coloring.
Can you go back a couple of slides to the square root seeker result, even more? That k minus square root seeker. That one. So is the dependence on c required there on the completeness part? Or does it come from the fact that you just need the c coloring to be guaranteed?
Oh, right. So I mean, like, you're asking, is something like k minus 1 c?
No, I was talking about the general problem where you mentioned that you don't need to use every color in the edge. So you had k minus square root ck and k minus 3 square root ck, right?
Yeah.
So there is the dependence on c needed in the, like, can I get something like k minus root k and k minus 3 root k for every C coloring? Or does it come from the guarantee that's needed? Usually the analytical results give that any C coloring is not possible, right? And that C doesn't appear in the completeness usually.
Because
it comes very weird. Yeah,
because they come with an independent set guarantee too, right? Usually. Mm-hmm.
So these
things can't, these things don't get.
Yeah, so somehow, do you think that C has to appear?
That I have.
So there are no low bounds for these low bounds.
So I think this is also something that I know at least some people believe.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, yeah. So.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
So that's about rainbow coloring, but I'll show how to use the similar kind of proof technique with other kinds of gadgets to get other reductions. So the results won't be state of the art; they'll be kind of subpar, but they're new and hopefully they're the proofs are new and there's some hopeful direction for improvement. Like, again, like as long as it's just a matter of finding a gadget. So let's get back to problem template one, and I'll just show one example of this, and let's stick to 4 uniform, 3 colorable graphs, and you want to output it's not rainbow anymore, it's just 4 uniform and 3 colorable graphs, and you want to output some polylog and coloring of this. Okay, so in fact the NP hardness of this is known for C equal to 2, but like in different ways. I'll just say, okay if I replace it by 2, even there the proof has like similar ideas here, but I'll just show it for 3 to show different types of gadgets. So this is a gadget, a set subset of 0, 1, 2 to the n, okay? And that's a gadget. What is the property I want from this? It is that for every subset of T of size at least delta is some parameter that will be tuned. There are 2 points that agree on fewer than T coordinates. So this is kind of a gadget here. So now you'll get, okay, as a, I guess, spoiler here, you'll get independent set guarantees because of things like this. Right. The gadget is a follower. Yeah. So this is the gadget. You have a subset of 1, 2, 3 to the n. So it's that for every large enough subset of S, there are two points that don't agree on that agree on fewer than t places. Okay. Yeah. So AG's agreement, right? Which is n minus a Hamming distance of between. Thing, right? So AG is the number of points where they match. So what's an example? S is 3 to the n is an example of this. And it's not at all obvious, this one, the fact that this is an example. This is a theorem by Frankel and Tokushika and Alfrede Kachetian. So this type of conditions are seem to be pretty hard to prove for 3 to the n. But the hope is that they use really different techniques. So. Okay, I'll describe the reduction again briefly here. It'll be more or less the same flavor. So we start off with the label cover instance. It has some kind of soundness guarantees and all the expand, like all of the previous things and only two layers. Oh, by the way, I should also like a caveat. So all of this is going to be it's quasi NP hard, but like I said, like for the sake of this, I won't distinguish between. I won't make this distinction. Some kind of NP hardness is okay. So here's a reduction. Consider two variables. So again, projection constraints in the same kind of soundness, etc. And now consider two variables x1 and x2, and with a common neighbor y, and put a copy of S, again, like similar to the previous case, put a copy of the gadget for every vertex. And look at U1, U2, and V1, V2. For every A, B such that, I mean, should set the opposite way. So, right, for every A and B whose projections match, pick U1, U2, V1, V2, where you see at least two entries in these four places. Okay. And then you put, and I guess I did not draw that thing. And then you put a hyperedge between these. So now it's a four uniform hypergraph, right? So for every A and B that have the common projection, find two vertices here, two vertices there with that show you at least two different points, and you put a common input and it's there. Again, so when I tell the proof of the completeness, this kind of, it will be clear. Okay, so again, suppose you have an assignment. I'll tell you how to color. So let A be an assignment, two vertices over of U and V. And the coloring is exactly as you'd expect. It's just color every vertex U with whatever you see here. Right? Because like you see at least two different values in both of these things, so you can't have monochromatic edges. So that's the completeness. The soundness will kind of use this agreeing property. In fact, you get, like I said, you get an independent set guarantee. You get that you can't even distinguish between being three colorable and having independent set of size at most something. Okay. So you have to show that if the independence fraction is at least delta, then there exists an assignment satisfying at least some fraction of constraints. Okay. And the way to do it is the following. You have, this is how the hypergraph looks. So I'll use this pink color to denote the independence set. So if you have an independence fraction of at least delta, by similar averaging arguments, just assume that it takes a delta fraction of every cloud. Now, Now use the fact that if you take at least a delta fraction of the cloud, you have two points which agree on fewer than t places. Okay, and in every two of them, so in every one you see two points that agree in very few places. And moreover, the projections of these agreements must pairwise intersect, because otherwise they form a hyperedge. And I guess the punchline is that if you have an intersecting family, some vertex must have a high degree. So that means some assignment here is present in a lot of projections. So just again, if you pick randomly, you at least set that fraction of, satisfy that fraction of entries, and it's a very similar argument. So that's, I guess, without, so it's just the skeleton of the argument without any details. Okay, and this is pretty, yeah, it's pretty simple, I guess. So here's the main open problem. So what stopped us from getting better bounds on the coloring is the size of the gadget, actually. So if you can construct gadgets with smaller size that have a similar property, then you actually get much better bounds. In particular, if you can find such a gadget of, previously the gadget was something like 3 to the n, right? If you can find this kind of gadget on 2 to the polylog n many points, then you can take D. So K equals 4, C equals 3, and D equals something like 2 to the polylog n. So I guess at this point the main hope comes from the fact that these techniques are pretty different, and so this tough to be done. And that's all I have to say. Thank you, Anne.
Thanks. Thank you for the talk. It was really nice. Are there some questions? Andre?
I guess lots of your gadgets, they have a pretty similar structure, right? The vertices are n tuples, your domain, and your condition is that in every coordinate something is satisfied.
Right.
And that is very close to the definition of a polymorphism.
Right.
Which is like this, right? You exactly like this. You have n tuples, and then you have a collection of tuples in every coordinate, some conditions is satisfied, and then the output values are supposed to satisfy some condition. It's not exactly that, right? Because of noise, but it's very close.
Would that also capture this kind of thing, for example? Because now I'm only talking about a subset of the 0, 1, 2 to the n tuples now.
Not sure about this. Jakob, what do you think?
I can't see it. I don't know. But I'm like confused about the uniformity here, like if you want to make it into a polymorphism.
I'm sorry?
No, yeah, I'm just like thinking how does it connect to these polymorphisms? I don't really see it. Maybe it's just two values. I don't know. Sorry.
It's kind of that your n-ary polymorphisms, they have the the range that depends on n somehow, right? So yeah, binary polymorphism might output you know, 4 possible values, ternary polymorphism, 8 possible values, and so on. Huh?
Because that's not necessarily a problem.
No, well, this because this D depends on N, which is the arity.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We do know how this business works with polymorphisms. You know, when D is not a constant, but it can grow with N.
Okay. Some other questions? So maybe I will have a question. So this kind of topological argument in your proof, it's used in this Knezer like result, right? So you're analyzing the gadgets.
Yeah.
How does the proof compare to this Knezer graph proof?
It's everything is a generalization. So Knezer graph, you look for antipodal pairs of points, right? So instead of that, you have a sphere and you define some free group action, and you want a point orbit whose orbit should have the same value, and so that kind of forms a hyperedge. That means you have a monochromatic hyperedge. So with that kind of generalization, it's the exact same proof.
Okay, cool. Thanks. Some other questions? Yeah, if not, let's thank Aditya again, virtually. and if you want to socialize again, the meeting is open. Just unmute yourself. I should probably stop the recording now. So.